Two videos back, I did a bunch of tests on whether resin or filament prints were stronger. Basically, the resins we use, at least that's the common impression, they're much more brittle than the plastics we use as filaments. But on the other hand, resin prints have no layer adhesion issues, so I wanted to find out if that would actually make resin prints weaker or stronger in the end. Turns out that it depends really is the only answer here, and we saw the prints from the Elegoo ABS-like resin slightly beat out PETG in almost every discipline, while the Prusa resin was considerably weaker in many use cases. But I hadn't tested whether the direction my samples were printed in actually mattered, so I started working on testing that as a follow-up. But turns out, it only raised more questions than it answered. So let's dig through those today and see how deep that rabbit hole takes us. Okay, let's cut right to the chase. Originally, I had only printed the impact and bend tests in one orientation. Bend tests were printed standing up and the impact tests were printed flat. I did that to speed up printing and to save a bit of resin, only one sample instead of three or two. Remember, unlike the filament tests, these samples are all 100% infill, so they use up quite a bit of material. But you know what isn't 100%? That is the percentage of you who are watching but aren't subscribed, so just click that button. There, thanks. Okay, so to test whether orientation mattered, I reprinted all the parts for the bend test and the impact test and the pull test in all orientations twice. I wanted to make sure these parts would be consistent and not dependent on where exactly they were sitting in the CW1 for curing, where they would maybe get a slightly different dose of UV light, because I had already suspected that curing actually had some sort of an impact on my results in the last round, even though the CW1 should be fairly consistent. But in this round, it didn't get better. In fact, the results were massively all over the place. So first off, I was reprinting the bend tests at 75% scale, again, saving some material. But I got totally different results compared to the last time I printed them, even though I was using the exact same print settings, the same material, in this case, of course, the Elegoo ABS-like, and the same curing cycle, which is even temperature controlled in the CW1. The first time I tested this part in resin, I was able to load it with 8.1 kilograms before it failed. But on this new second run, I got 2.5 and 4.3 kilograms for the part printed flat, and 5 and 6.3 kilograms for the ones printed upright. So, okay, first off, every single one of these prints was way weaker than the one I printed the first time around. But also, if you look at the numbers again, not only were they scattered all over the place, but also the parts printed flat, or this one, ended up being significantly weaker than the one printed standing up. So the ones that were printed in a way that would peel the layers apart in the test were actually stronger than the ones printed flat, kind of being loaded in the direction of the layers. For reference, with filament prints, there's usually a 4x difference in the ones printed flat being stronger, not weaker. Now, I realize my test setup isn't perfect by any means. After all, for most of these tests, it's me, a human, putting my body weight onto a bar that pulls down on a scale. There are a lot of factors that could deviate here, but I've done a few tests in the past with filament on how repeatable my results, you know, achieved this way are, and I get within 5 to 10% or so for each individual discipline, and of course that also includes deviations in the filament or the print itself. And even though I rarely did multiple samples for a single material, so multiple samples of the same discipline, the overall scores are always an average of multiple separate tests, multiple disciplines, so it does average out and give an overall good look at what a material will do in the overall score. So if two materials are within 5 or 10% in the final score, I doubt many people will notice a difference in real use anyways. But this was different. Not only are we seeing deviations by a factor of almost 4, we're also seeing differences in exactly the opposite direction we would expect. And I checked, no, I didn't mix up my results. Instead, what I think was happening here is that the two parts were cured differently. So, you see, the one printed standing up had that brim on the bottom that also allowed it to be cured standing up in the CW1, while the other ones had to lay flat down on the platform. So that's both true for the bend test and for the impact test. The platform on the CW1 is perforated in a large area, but the exposure in UV light is probably still different enough to cause a significant difference between this and that in the way these are cured. Interestingly though, I only saw these deviations in the bend tests and not in, for example, the impact tests, which were also printed and cured in these different orientations. All these parts were printed at the same time. Maybe these cured with less deviation? I don't know. I could start interpreting the results, but I'm not comfortable doing that just yet before I've got a bit more data. So the only logical thing to do for me was to print everything again and do curing a bit differently. And that's what I did. Same resin, same print files, but this time I cured each set of parts 4 separate times and I shuffled them around on the rotating platter before I started each cure cycle. The CW1's default is set to 3 minutes of drying and heating and then another 3 minutes of UV exposure. I had already cranked it up to 5 minutes drying, 5 minutes curing for all these tests. So overall, this second test has a total of 20 minutes of UV exposure in the CW1 for each part. I don't believe you can overcure these with the relatively low energy UV light we're getting here. But yeah, just let me know in the comments if that's something you'd be interested in and I can maybe look into whether you can overcure these maybe in sunlight in the future. So did that improve things? I guess, yeah. There was still more variation in these results than what I'm used to and what I'm actually comfortable with. But at least we can look at what trends we're seeing because those are undeniably there. So the bend tests that were pretty horrible before are now back at a comparable level of what I saw in the first round of tests. I got 7.1 and 6.8 kilograms for layer strength and 7.5 and 9.9 kilograms for layer adhesion, which is in line with the first round of prints I tested. But it's still striking that the layer adhesion parts were stronger in this case than the layer strength ones. Not by much, but again, the exact opposite of what you'd expect. The impact test stayed roughly the same actually. The numbers say the parts that were cured 4 times are in total about 10% more impact resistant, but there was still a lot of variation. For example, the specimen with the notch printed on the side, this is typically the strongest one, went from 750 and 850 millijoules to 700 and 1130-ish millijoules, which comes out to a higher average, but then one is lower, the other is higher, so yeah. What we can definitely see though is that there seems to be the same dependency on part orientation for the impact tests that we're used to seeing on filament prints. Let's take the part that's been printed flat with the notch up. I'm struggling to find the two matching halves here, but anyways, notch up, so this orientation. So these parts have interrupted layers on either side of the notch. That was 675 millijoules absorbed on average. The parts printed flat with the notch on the side, so facing like in the Z direction, was 27% stronger on average. My thinking is that's because the layers are uninterrupted in that orientation. And then looking at the parts printed standing up, like so, those were about 18% weaker than our reference. Now, granted, that is much less of a difference than with filament prints, which in the impact tests usually turn out 3 to 5 times as strong printed flat versus printed standing up. But the most impact resistant resin orientation is still about 50% better than the worst one. So yes, in this case, we do see a very noticeable difference that would suggest that resin does care about orientation. But as we jump to the last test I did, the pull test with these rings, usually these are complete loops, but anyways, I don't think these results are usable at all. Because first of all, you know, just like in the bend test, I saw one part that was printed to test layer adhesion like that, actually outperforming another that was printed flat. If only I had complete rings here. And then when I quad cured the second set of parts, I completely ran out of capacity on my luggage scale. I did get all the parts to break, but I don't have a reading to tell me how far past the maximum 40 kilograms they made it. So are resin prints actually isotropic parts, meaning they have the same mechanical properties in all orientations? No, definitely not. Of course, this can depend on print settings, resins, etc. But from what I've seen on the Prusa SL1 using the Elegoo ABS-like resin, there definitely are differences. But while the impact tests have very similar trends to how, you know, filament tests behave, the bend and pull tests actually seem to be slightly contradicting that by performing better on average when printed in a way that would separate the layers, that would just pull them apart. Now, I do script most of my videos beforehand, this one included, so I've had some time to think about why this might be happening, and the only good explanation that I was able to come up with, or I guess it's more of a speculation, is that resin prints end up with, I don't want to say layers, but plies or gradient within one layer with varying hardness. Maybe imagine it like how a spine has rigid vertebrae and then elastic discs between them. In the low case that we pull on the entire thing, the softer plies stretch and conform, and just like, for example, PETG, help distribute the load across the entire cross-section of the part. But in bending or sideways load, if you take our spine sideways, the entire stress is taken up by just the plies that are harder, while the softer ones just flex away and conform without helping support the load. In my mind, that makes a lot of sense right now. And I think that's even consistent with what the bend test was doing, but I could be completely wrong. If you have a different explanation for what I've seen or have made entirely different observations yourself, please do let me know in the comments below. I'm finding these details quite fascinating, but I also wouldn't have expected that the resin prints would end up performing so inconsistently. Even in the impact tests, which remove me as a human element for, you know, performing the test, this is just a fixture basically, there still seems to be enough leeway in the entire printing process to create some quite unpredictable results. In either case, I hope you found this test just as interesting as I did, but I think I'll take it easy on resin printing tests for a bit, especially since I'm already feeling my nose and my throat, getting reactions to that resin smell again when I just walk into the studio here that had a printer doing its thing. But yeah, make sure you're subscribed, and if you don't want to miss new videos, make sure to get that bell on as well. I hope you noticed, but I'm trying to get on a weekly upload schedule every Friday afternoon. There's more to come. Hope you enjoyed. Keep on making, and I will see you in the next one.